The woke progressives in media have the ability, with their megaphone, to directly affect economic markets. And so they come out here and they talk, they create this hysteria without any context. They want this to happen so that then they can pin the virus and the negative economic impact on President Donald Trump. My question, how worried are you out there really about the coronavirus? And if you're some of those people who've driven, again, contagion up to number 8 on iTunes, don't answer this because you're going to taint the questioning pool. The polling data will be skewed. Do you think the media is max? Okay, just let me, did you fight anyone for toilet paper? How big of a deal do you think the coronavirus is? I don't want to, it could get bad. At some point, okay, yeah. So I don't want you to go back here and say you said it would never get bad. It could get bad, but I will say this. Right now, the media desperately wants us to have another economic collapse under Donald Trump. They will use the coronavirus if they have to. It's as simple as that. We'll be getting into in this segment some numbers that I think might interest you, comparing the swine flu to the number of deaths in coronavirus versus those infected, the death rates, the media coverage they're in, some real global crises that maybe you actually might have to worry about if we're looking at pure raw numbers. There are a significant number of things that are more likely to kill you than the coronavirus. For example, more of you just died walking under a ladder than have died yet in the United States from the coronavirus.
Sorry. Actual corona could also kill you.
Since the intro of the show.
Since the introduction of the show. So before we get to it, though, I'm sure you guys have seen this. Obviously, people have gone into a panic, emptying the shelves, the hand sanitizer, toilet paper. It's been a rough go with the coronavirus.
Boom.
It's my toilet paper.
Okay, so let me give you the worst case scenario, the worst that's happened. All right, markets this morning opened up huge declines. This was a national story. Senator Ted Cruz quarantined himself after CPAC because there was someone there who might have had coronavirus, and then people are making a big deal out of Italy's leaked plan to potentially quarantine 16 million people. That's causing all kinds of chaos. Here's something. Let me just put this in context for you. When people talk about these things as though they are insurmountable problems, by this time tomorrow, and by the way, at the time of this recording, the markets have rallied quite a bit. So you're talking about a loss of less than 3% if you compare it percentage-wise to the Great Depression or the crash of 2008. It's not even close. We'll get into that in a second. But this time tomorrow, by this time tomorrow, Ted Cruz could come out, Senator Ted Cruz, and say, hey, guys, I'm fine. Italy could say, you know what? We don't really need to quarantine 16 million people. That was just a bunch of people freaking out over nothing. And the markets could have rebounded. It could not be less relevant. We may be totally fine by this point tomorrow. Again, contagion will still be trending number 8 on iTunes. It doesn't solve that problem. Yeah. It was a piece of shit in 2011. Why would you think it's prescriptive of how to act during the coronavirus?
Nice.
No, it's not nice.
It is nice.
I know that's a word whisker of yours, but I'm very upset by this. So let's
trying to calm you down.
Let's go through some of the claims here that are being made by the media versus the reality. Okay. Of course, the media has tried to make this disease about. Or virus about Donald. I have to get that right because we'll get really upset.
Watch out, man.
By the way, I never said AIDS was a hoax. I said the AIDS epidemic, meaning 1 in 3 heterosexual couples, according to Oprah, would be affected by 1994. The idea of a prolific epidemic was a hoax. I'm not saying that the coronavirus doesn't exist or that it was created in an underground lab with communist Chinese people and Alex Jones. That's not what I'm saying. I'm just saying it is not as dire as the media wants you to believe, who are in the process crashing global economic markets, or at least trying to. That's not even happening yet. So the media, of course, has tried to make this about President Donald Trump. This comes from Media Research Center.
This administration has a war on science, often for political reasons, but it should still shock you that Trump slashed the government agencies that would have been responsible for handling an outbreak.
Some of the criticism coming at the White House is that they have been cutting positions. Your position that you held on the National Security Council, for example, are you concerned that this is impacting their response?
Is he worried that more about, you know, his best case for re-election than the real health threat here?
Is the president misleading the American people about the virus and the outbreak?
Given Vice President Pence's history as governor dealing with the recent public health crisis, is he the best equipped to lead this effort at the White House?
Do you think that he's the right point person?
Is that the right way to handle a deadly epidemic?
Here's the thing, Mr. President. Pandemics don't care about politics.
But you do.
You certainly do.
Something important. A couple weeks ago, the New York Times, they actually ran an op-ed arguing that we should call this the Trump virus. And leftists were celebrating the hashtag on Twitter, pushing it to the number 2 trend of the day. If we're going to be naming the virus based on its source, wouldn't communist ass virus be more apt? I mean, it did come from China. It has nothing to do with President Donald Trump. So the first thing that we've been hearing, though, is, of course, we're going into this recession, right? Again, this morning, the market crash was pushed to the top of the United States trends. You had, of course, all of the anti-Trump accounts who were tweeting it. Leftists, progressives widely celebrating the next crash as an example of Donald Trump's failure. Here's the truth. We are not anywhere near a recession. If you look at the numbers, it's not even close to what we experienced in 2008 or the Great Depression. But going into 2020 is especially rough for Democrats because of a great economy that most Americans have agreed, by the way. Not only the objective parameters, not only the objective measurements, but also the polling data shows that Americans think the economy is doing very well.
Because it is.
So the left right now, they desperately are hoping for a recession so they can pin it on Trump. Lest you believe me not, if that's a phrase. Remember this, Bill Maher?
Josh, isn't the Fed cutting rates now just going to make the next economic downturn worse? What's your prediction? I've been hoping for a recession. People hate me for it, but it would get rid of Trump, so you shouldn't hate me for it.
I mean, recessions are really bad. People lose their jobs and their homes, and we shouldn't wish
it. It's worth it.
But,
prick!
I've got millions of dollars.
I know.
I'll be totally fine. It's worth
you
it.
You people who need your jobs, okay?
Yeah.
Okay, people, we need a recession. Just piss off, Bill Maher.
Oh, my gosh.
By the way, also, after the initial coronavirus the scare, New York Times economist, we use that term loosely, Paul Krugman tweeted, called it the Trump virus, and the recession was seemingly celebrating again the Dow drop, okay? So here's something that's important to note while we're talking about this. Again, these markets could recalibrate tomorrow.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This is not unprecedented, it's not unheard of, and it's not catastrophic. The coronavirus is a global pandemic. Right, it's a global phenomenon. Pandemic, that's redundant to say global pandemic. I think pandemic means global, pretty much. Right, Audio Aid, you can fact check me on that. Pandemic tends to imply global. But today, the oil market crash is because of a glorified Swanson measuring contest between Saudi Arabia and Russia. It has nothing to do. Nothing to do with President Trump. Nothing to do with the coronavirus. But it is interesting because I was just reading an article, I think in the New York Times the other day, where they were talking about how gas is too cheap, so too many Americans are driving rather than taking public transportation. They're choosing SUVs because they want to be safe.
Again?
So we need to artificially fix the price of gas for it to be higher. No, you're not anti-human. You're not anti-middle class working Americans who like cheap gas and like being safe when they're on the freeways. By the way, third world folks from the Honduras, they'll just die. They'll just die if they need to warm up their food, they need to cook their food, they need to boil their water, they need to keep their houses warm at night. Couldn't care less about them, but here's the point. If you did all of this, which has been advocated from the left, you still can't nerf the world because Russia and Saudi Arabia have a hot temper and they get into some kind of an oil arms race.
Oh my
God. Markets fluctuate. Wait, there is a big picture to see. In 2008, now I think, I don't have the numbers in front of me, but if I'm not mistaken, and someone can fact check me on this, I'm going by rote here. We don't have any overlays or anything like that. The crash in 2008, from right before the day of the crash to its lowest point, from George W. Bush to Barack Obama, the markets, I think the S&P dumped about 50%, if I'm not mistaken.
It was insane.
Since then, do you know how much it's gone up? When people say my 401k is gone, if you sell it this second, 500%.
Wow,
since the crash. 50% down, 500% up. In World War II, we had, 70 plus million people died? In Europe, in Asia, you're talking about markets that were decimated. The market went up 12% per year.
Now let's get recovered.
Yeah, exactly. And this is, by the way, I said this was going to happen when Barack Obama was president.
Yeah.
You can go back and I said, listen, the risk is already built into the fact before he has become president. But let's compare the media's messaging. This is important. Under, speaking of him, Barack Obama and the swine flu. What was it? Don't panic, all is well. And the Dow Jones actually increased, went up during that period. Now, keep in mind, under Obama, during the, I think it was April 2009 to, was it 2010? You have this, bring it up there, Court of Black Carrot. We had over 274,000 swine flu hospitalizations. 12,000 deaths. That's over 500 times as much as the coronavirus. That's not to say that the coronavirus couldn't get that bad eventually, but it's nowhere near that now. And what matters is the media's hysteria that you saw at that point with Barack Obama, where they're saying this really isn't that severe, to now with Donald Trump. What does matter is the double standard at this point and that markets and people's psyche are being manipulated by this right now. By the way, hit the notification bell if you haven't already. If you're on YouTube, hit all notifications because subscriptions don't mean a whole lot. Crowder Bits is another YouTube channel where you can watch the short segments and sketches. And please do consider joining Mug Club. That's what allows us to keep the lights on. Speaking of Barack Obama, I think this is important. When you look at the media's coverage versus the handling of swine flu versus coronavirus. And in Canada, we had SARS. Sorry about that.
You're
bad.
Did you do it?
I don't know. No, it was, surprise, surprise, it was the Asians again. Oh, it was all of a sudden, if it's if it's not the Chinese in China, it's the Chinese at the Toronto airport.
Oh, boy.
Not
blaming all Chinese.
So the pundits, right, they've been saying that his response is terrible. This is what we've heard about Donald Trump. And even if you voted for Donald Trump, you can say, I voted for Donald Trump, I think his response is terrible. You'd be wrong, because he's been much more on the ball than President Obama was with the H1N1, not to be confused with the lottery visas. The H1N1 was the swine flu. So let's compare. H1B. When did Barack Obama declare a state of emergency over the swine flu? This is really important. If you remember nothing else and you share one moment from this video with your friends, this is irrefutable, undeniable. These are hard numbers. Barack Obama declared a state of emergency over the swine flu after millions of Americans were affected, over 20,000 hospitalized, over 1,000 Americans had died.
Yeah.
Okay? Let's contrast that with President Trump declared an emergency after how many deaths? How many? One! One death!
Wow, that's less.
One death! National emergency.
That's much less.
That's almost 999, less than 1,000.
Precisely.
Can you imagine the media's reaction if President Donald... You see what it is right now. Yeah. If President Donald Trump waited to 1,000 Americans dying...
Millions of people infected.
To declare it a national emergency.
I think he's on the ball.
Yeah, he's doing a good job.
And what it's important is right now they play this sort of this little bit of sleight of hand where they go, oh, he slashed. Well, listen, if you cut anything, if you were to cut, let's say, 0.1% of government across the board in every single sector, because you say we need to be able to pay for some of this stuff, and we can't pay for it. 0.1%, guess what? You would still be talking about billions of dollars being cut from these programs. Because if you cut anything, of course that's a cutback. That being said, the design, the infrastructure of this government, of course, is more in line with that of Federalists, of conservatives, and that the federal government is now, hopefully, and it seems to be working pretty well, they're being positioned to help local governments, state governments, to provide them with what they need in these states of emergencies, because they know that local legislatures will better know how to serve their constituents. And it's working actually really well. Just this morning, Gavin Newsom, the governor of California, okay, Democrat, not a big fan of Donald Trump. I think he sued Donald Trump. He said that Pence's handling of the situation was fantastic. He said it was everything he could have hoped for. That's a direct quote, and that the administration has since followed through with all of their promises. Should be noted, that's just Pence lulling him to a state of complacency, and then he's going to electrocute him because he's a California. That being said, now, at this snapshot in time, it looks pretty good. This was something that was very interesting to me. To stop the spread of the coronavirus, again, didn't wait until 1,000 deaths. As a matter of fact, this was before the first death, but most people don't remember that. Donald Trump put a restricted travel. I don't want to say a ban, but a moratorium on Chinese travel back to the United States beginning of January.
Yeah.
Okay, there were zero confirmed cases of the coronavirus at this point. Death toll in the whole world hadn't reached 100. 1,000, Barack Obama, 1,000 dead in America. No deaths. No deaths in the United States, less than 100 globally. Okay, so they put this ban out there. I don't remember anyone talking about how this was racist. No one had a problem with it.
Yeah.
Then there was Trump's Muslim ban, the moratorium, right, on seven countries?
Something like that.
Well, keep in mind, by the way, that it was the Obama administration who initially identified these countries as countries of concern. But I'm just comparing this. We have a travel ban to try and quarantine a virus, right, from a foreign country. No one has a problem with it. When we had effectively what was a travel quarantine to try and control, to try and quarantine terrorism, people were offended. Terrorists, by the way, terrorism kills roughly 21,000 people a year worldwide. Just to be clear, while we're talking about the numbers. A study on United States terrorism found that from 1992 to the time Trump instituted the travel ban moratorium in 2017, terrorists killed over 3,300 Americans, and Islamists were responsible for 92% of those deaths. So I just want to be really clear, while we're talking about pandemics and a threat to your life, you think that you should be avoiding this, obviously. But really, what you should be avoiding is this. And this seems like it should be self-explanatory, because he's got bombs and immigration. This is important, like you brought up. Now, it seems obvious, given all the information, that restricting travel immigration is important.
Would be.
Logical. Then there's Elizabeth Warren. So,
on the other side of the scale.
In steps in Elizabeth.
Keep in mind, by the way, that she stopped running for president, but she is still a senator. Mm. So she can still actually introduce legislation.
Oh, no.
And she has introduced some legislation right now amid the coronavirus to what? What priorities? Divert all funds away from the border wall.
I'm going to be introducing a plan tomorrow to take every dime that the president is now spending on his racist wall at our southern border and divert it to work on the coronavirus.
Yeah, because you know what you need amidst a global pandemic? Open borders.
Get those people in.
Not only that, let's make sure that not only do they not sign the guest book, let's throw away the guest book.
Takes time to sign it.
How much spending does she want, by the way, for spending? $400 billion.
Oh, really?
$400 billion.
Oh, that's a lot.
And this is a good example, too, where you want to know that there's a degree of how much everybody supports borders to some extent. Even the people who say, well, you know what, man, I think we are the world and want to hold a hand with that sort of multifaceted flag that looks like it was, you know, embroidered on a quilt. Right in the coronavirus right now, you say, okay, what should we do as far as knowing who's coming into the country? Well, I think we need to do something right now. We need to show that the government's not doing enough. Yeah. There you go. You believe in borders. It just matters. It's just, to what extent do you believe in borders?
Right.
There is no one who really believes in open borders when there is a foreign threat of biological, I don't want to say biological warfare because that would describe intent.
No.
I don't believe that. But a biological threat to the American people. Everyone believes in borders to some degree. Elizabeth Warren notwithstanding. And here's what really bothers me right now, too, is this the media right now? Let's be honest. We've drawn these connections before. ABC, NBC, CBS, CNN, Vox. I mean, they've gone after us personally. Vox, NBC, Universal, ABC, Disney, and I don't know who
it's
else.
All together.
But we've personally had to deal with lawsuits with them. All of these entities obviously are very far left. Okay, they tend to lean very far left. These people in the media, they are one and the same with the Democratic Party right now. They actively have a politically vested interest in there being an economic recession. And here's what's important right now. The left, the woke progressives in media have the ability with their megaphone to directly affect economic markets. And so they come out here and they talk, they create this hysteria without any context. They didn't do it with Barack Obama. That's how we looked at the economic progress that was happening during that time, because they were saying, don't panic, all is well. Whereas at this point, when there is no reason to panic yet, there is no reason for people to be going out and punching old ladies in the face for hand sanitizer, but they are because of this media hysteria at this point. They want this to happen so that then they can pin the virus and the negative economic impact on President Donald Trump. This is why the American public distrusts media. I want to be really clear about this. I'm not doing the guy on CNN talking to Donald Trump. I know that there's someone in media right now who's watching this, if not hundreds of you, because we take the phone calls and we go, ha ha ha, click. No, I'm not doing your show. But my point is this right now, okay? You guys are creating exactly what you want. And the American public, they don't trust you, because with this, they can see it's not that you have differing political stances at this point. It's not that there's a difference of opinion as it relates to taxes or as it relates to even abortion at this point, what might have at one point seemed like unifying issues in comparison to the coronavirus and the pandemonium or guns. No. These people who believe in putting the American public first, they understand that you couldn't possibly want that, because you are willing, and you openly, from people like Bill Maher who openly say it, to people like Wolf Blitzer who openly think it and then say it, not realizing that the words are coming out of their mouth, but we hear it anyway. The point is, these people are willing to sacrifice the livelihood. You guys out there right now, media folks who are watching, you're willing to sacrifice the livelihoods of Americans so long as it gives you the economic collapse that you're hoping for and you can pin it on President Donald Trump. You don't put America first. You don't put the American people first. That's why you're dying. That's why programs like this are swallowing you whole and you are going away, and you're only shocked when you come back to contract negotiations and then Chris Cuomo goes, holy shit, you don't have the money to pay me that? No, because no one watches you, Chris Cuomo. No one believes you anymore. You hate America, you hate what it stands for, and you hate the American public through your actions in trying to subvert our economic systems, so long as you get your way in making the president look bad. Hey there, YouTube viewers, subscribe to the channel, hit the notification bell if you're already subscribed to this channel, because that lets you know when new videos come out and they don't show up on the YouTube search feed. Also, there are videos playing in boxes here. Click one of those. Just of all the things that I just mentioned, all you have to do is one. And if you don't, I will run for the United States presidency under the 1,064th% Cherokee Party. I have yet to pick my VP.